So I would like to introduce Professor Prithvi Singh Kandhal, who is currently the Associate Director of the NCAT, which is National Center for Asphalt Technology, which is based in US. And NCAT, if you were to be precise, is the largest asphalt road technology center in the world. And prior to NCAT, he has served as the Chief Asphalt Road Engineer of the Pennsylvania Department of Transportation for 17 years. And he has served as a President, International Association of Asphalt Paving Technology, and also as a Chairman, American Society for Testing and Materials, International Committee on Road Paving Standards, and Chairman, U.S. Transportation Research Board Committee on Asphalt Roads. And also recently he has developed new standards for IRC, which is Indian Road Congress. And he has also got a Lifetime Achievement Award in Asphalt Road Technology from the International Association of Asphalt Paving Technologists during the annual banquet held in Austin at US. We have invited him personally here because based on the requirements that we have received from the site, wherein they wanted to learn more about the advancement in the construction technologies and how the, advancement in the construction technologies and also about the maintenance. So over to you, sir. You
Thank
can
you.
Actually highlight.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The topics in this first lecture are introduction, historical background, refining, very briefly how bitumen is refined, types and uses. Type means we have paving bitumen, we have cutback, we have emulsion, those kind of things. And lastly, we will have conventional physical properties like viscosity, penetration, things of that nature. As you all know that asphalt mixed materials, bitumen is one part and aggregate is the other part. Bitumen is sort of like a glue which glues together all the aggregate particles. And you can see in the picture that we have the bitumen in the beaker and we got whitish aggregate and then we got asphalt concrete specimen. So we have to proportion the aggregate and bitumen to make a good asphalt concrete or bituminous concrete so that we can pave our national highways. They have a very good quality bituminous concrete, asphalt concrete, which can include DBM and everything. When I say also, we can design a good airfield with bituminous pavement. I have privilege to design some airfields in the Middle East with the bituminous materials. We also use the bituminous concrete for residential streets, which you can see here in development. So here you see the use of bituminous concrete in the residential area. You can also use the bituminous concrete in a racetrack. You can see here how they are doing the rolling and the paving, you know, suspended from the top because it's a very steep slope. Also, asphalt mix, which is like more like design as a hydraulic mix, can be used to line the water reservoirs so that water doesn't leak out. Also in the US they also use the asphalt base course under the ballast for the railways. We don't use it here, but that's one more use for the asphalt concrete. Now when we say bitumen, it includes both tar and asphalt cement. In the US they call bitumen asphalt cement, although we can say also is asphaltic bitumen. But the common public thinks that the tar and bitumen are same, asphaltic bitumen are same. The confusion is because both of them are black, both are used for highways, but there is a big difference there. Tar is manufactured from destructive distillation of bituminous coal. So tar is a different origin, entirely different origin from coal, whereas the asphalt cement or asphalt bitumen, or we simply call it bitumen in India, is made from petroleum crude mainly. So there is a big difference in there which common public doesn't see. So when we talk about bitumen, that's what we are going to talk about. We are going to talk about bitumen refined from the petroleum crude. It can be refined from petroleum crude. It can also occur as a natural bitumen. Bitumen also occurs as a natural. In the natural bitumen, we have the so-called lake bitumen and rock bitumen. The lake bitumen on the left side, you see it comes from Trinidad Lake, that's in South America. There's a big lake in there, you know, and you take out the bitumen and it brings up more bitumen. Seems like more like a refining by nature. The crude oil might be very deep, but through the rocks it comes up, you know, and it just comes like refined like a bitumen. And the rock bitumen is also called gilsonite. It's mined in the state of Utah in the US. It occurs between the rock layers like sandstone or limestone, like a layer of bitumen, small. So again, what I said is Trinidad Lake asphalt bitumen was used in the US during 1870s for roads and streets. It contained about 50% to 70% bitumen. Rest was colloidal clay of volcanic origin. At that time, there was no petroleum crude oil available at that time. People even didn't know about petroleum crude. So the early 1900s saw popularity of automobiles and discovery of refining process for petroleum crude. So gradually, the refined bitumen replaced the natural bitumen. So now we'll talk about the refining process very, very briefly. It's a very complex process, but we'll talk about that. Here is a typical oil well from which we are getting the crude oil from the ground. It is like a battery of crude oil, petroleum oil wells, which are connected with the pipeline. It's just like we have like in Barmer in Rajasthan. We have a very big oil finding there. A lot of oil fields are there. We also have oil wells which are offshore, like we have in Bombay High. In Bombay High, it's like offshore, away from the land. And from all these sources, the petroleum crude is brought to the refinery and they're stored there in large tanks for refining. And briefly, the refining, this, you see, the complex is very, very highly complex. You have to be a petroleum engineer to understand what's going on in there. No, I'm a civil engineer like you. I don't know what's going on. All I know is I just need bitumen, you know. I'll then test that. But there's a lot of products are coming from petroleum crude. And what we do here is first we have the petroleum crude is heated. Then it enters the atmospheric tower, the called so far atmospheric tower. So heated crude oil comes in here and the lighter fractions will go in the top. Heavy fractions will be right here and middle one will be right here. So it's kind of automatically, because of its different temperature to become gas, you know, it becomes divided in there. And then we have trays around it where it's condensed now. So at this level, whatever I have, I might have petrol in here, which will be condensed, you know, and goes collected there. Then I might have the jet fuel or kerosene. Then I might have diesel at that level. Then I have fuel oil, industrial fuel oil. Then I have waxes, lubricating oils, grease. And after all these things are taken out, then I am left with bitumen. So bitumen used to be byproduct of the refining. It used to be very, very cheap. It was a byproduct, but now people are making a lot of money because the government, you know, subsidizes the diesel. The government does not subsidize the bitumen, so the companies keep on rising its price, you know, and we pay it on our roads. The public pays it for road without knowing all these things in here. So it's in a brief, you know, this is what we have in the atmospheric tower, and then we can take out further heavy oils by going to a vacuum tower and steam distillation. So I'm not going to go into all the details. So here we have different refining processes. We have atmospheric distillation, which I explained to you. Then we can have a vacuum distillation at reduced pressure to get more oil, heavy oil out of it. We have a solvent refining process, we have a rose, we have a controlled air blowing. I don't have time to discuss all of these things, but in briefly, solvent refining, whatever I am getting, the residue at the bottom, I divide into a hard bitumen and oil, and then I can blend them in different proportions to get my own viscosity grade or whatever I want, penetration. And in the rose process, I divide the residuum, which is the residual bitumen I obtain at the bottom of the tower, into three fractions, which is asphaltene, resins and oil. And then I can combine them all three in different proportions to what to my desired bitumen properties. You know. And air blowing can also be done to increase the viscosity a little bit. So these are different processes. I'm just going very, very briefly. And then very briefly, there are some how much bitumen you are going to get out of every petroleum crude oil. Like if you have a Bosque in Venezuela, this one is like 58% bitumen out of the whole petroleum crude. You know, this will give you more bitumen. Then this one will, this is Arabian, and this will give you less bitumen. And this right side in Nigeria is this, doesn't have hardly any bitumen. So every petroleum crude is different in terms of properties, how much bitumen you can get, what are the bitumen qualities are also can change from well to well. So coming to this bitumen, paving bitumen we are talking about, as at the room temperature it's a semi-solid. You can put your finger, you know, thumb on it and touch it, you know. It won't stick to your, at the room temperature, just like semi-solid. And as you heat it up, it becomes more and more liquid. So, and we'll talk about that later on, what the temperature does to that. First of all, let's talk about the types of bitumen binder. We have the neat bitumen binder, which is called asphalt cement in the US. We simply call it bitumen. Then we have cutback bitumen binder. Bitumen binder are cut with petroleum solvent. Just like oil paint, you know. Oil paint, if you want to thin it, oil paint, what do you do? If you oil paint, if you want to make it thin, you add some more solvent, right? And emulsified bitumen is bitumen, water and emulsifying agent. It doesn't have any solvent. You just somehow, although it's very hard to mix bitumen with water, but we'll know later on how we do it. So we got three kinds of bitumen binder. We got the neat bitumen, paving bitumen like VG10, VG30. Then we are cutbacks and emulsion. Three types. And we'll briefly talk about all these three. Cutback bitumen used to be used a long time ago, quite common when the emulsions were not very popular. We were using cutback, and it has three types. And I think go to the next slide to explain to you. So we have three types of cutback bitumen. We have the rapid curing RC, medium curing MC, slow curing SC. Rapid means, you know, where we want to apply the cutback and we want to make it evaporate the solvent very fast, because like a surface dressing or whatever, you know, when you apply and you want it to cure very fast, and that or same thing on tack coat. So in the tack coat for surface dressing you will use the rapid curing. But let me say this thing, we are not using any of these anymore, because cutbacks are being phased out and replaced with emulsion, except the MC type cutback. MC type cutback we use for primer, prime coat, and also for ready-made stockpile patching mix. Even the US, they make exception to, although the cutbacks are being banned, they make exception that cutbacks like MC30 and MC70 are very good prime coat. Because the emulsion we are using right now, you will have a lot of complaint in India from all over that my emulsion doesn't penetrate, you know, in WMM for days and days together. Water goes in there, but bitumen, so what good is that primer, you know? So I was a member of the Flexible Pavement Committee of Indian Roads Congress, so I recommended that we also use include MC30 and MC70 in there. So those who are out in the field, if you have any problem with the slow setting emulsion as a prime coat, you can use MC30 and MC70. It will do a very good job of prime coat. It's included in the IRAC code now. also on the MC 250 and MC 800.
Louder,
little louder. Loud kiya.
This
better. MC 800 we are using in a ready-made pothole patching mix, and I'll talk to about that when we talk about maintenance. I developed a mix in the U.S. in Pennsylvania, which is very good for India. Now, Indian Roads Congress has also made it a standard. I will discuss about that. So, these are the two uses we have for the medium curing cutback: MC3074 primer, MC800 for the ready-made pothole patching mix. Slow curing is bitumen plus oil. Let me again say that medium curing is made with kerosene. You just mix bitumen and kerosene. And these are different viscosity grade. This is low viscosity, this is high viscosity. If you add more kerosene, you will have low viscosity. If you add less kerosene, you will have high viscosity. So it's very easy to make. Slow curing is not used anywhere in the world as I know. So that's the cutback. And the issues with the cutback is that we have a high energy costly solvent which is wasted into the atmosphere. Once you apply the cutback, the solvent, whether it's kerosene or naphtha, it will go in the air, leaving behind the bitumen. Just like in the paint, you know, when the paint cures, becomes hard, all the solvent is gone, the turpentine oil, whatever you use in paint, same thing happens here. So, and we also have some sort of air pollution. In the US, they are very much particular in big cities, you know, they don't allow any cutback at all. The third thing, the safety. Cutback bitumen have low flash point. It has solvent, you know, so you cannot do any smoking, or there should not be any open flame near the cutbacks, you know, because it has solvent in it, so it can catch fire. So these are the three problems, and that's why we went to the emulsified bitumen, which is becoming very popular. So emulsified bitumen, we simply call it emulsion. It's a blend of bitumen, water, and an emulsifying agent. It's produced in a high shear colloid mill, and I'll show you a figure of that. Emulsion must break or set for water to be removed, leaving behind neat bitumen binder. So we got a mixture of water, bitumen and emulsion, the water. So that when the water gets out, or leaving behind pure bitumen, you know, which becomes hard. It's relatively pollution-free, safer to use compared to cutbacks, can be applied at low temperature and thus saving fuel cost. Now this is how the emulsion is manufactured. We have a hot bitumen tank. Whenever say asphalt, this is a slide from US, you know, so just read that like a bitumen. You got a hot bitumen tank, you got a water and emulsifier, which is a chemical. So you pump these under pressure, they combine it over here, and then they go through a rotor and a stator with a very, very tight clearance. So you are pumping this under pressure through that tight clearance at high temperature and pressure, and you are making emulsion out of it. And you can see the storage here, then you can store it here. And then that's how the emulsion will look like. We have water is the continuous medium, and your bitumen is like in the droplets. These are very fine droplets, you know, which are floating, not floating in the top, but throughout in the water. And that's your emulsion. Now, depending upon what kind of emulsifier you use, the chemical you, if you use a cationic emulsifier, you give a positive charge to all these droplets. All the droplets would have positive charge around them. So positive and same charge, what they are, do they attract or they repel? Same charge. They repel each other. So that's why these droplets don't combine, you know. They keep it away from each other. So they keep in suspension. If you use a alkaline type emulsifier, then you get an anionic emulsion, called anionic emulsion, cationic emulsion. In India, we use only cationic emulsion. In India, we only use this type. Whereas in the US, we use both of them. Now, the idea behind is that if I use a cationic emulsion, all my particles, bitumen particles, have a positive charge. And if I use a siliceous gravel, if I use like a sandstone, that would have a negative charge. So there is an attraction here. So the bitumen film will stick very good to a siliceous gravel or sandstone or type of material. If I got a limestone, limestone has positive charge, for that anionic emulsion will be very good. But we have found that in general, the cationic emulsion works okay for most of the aggregates. So in India, we have only cationic emulsion. And emulsion, just like cutback, we have three setting dates. We have a rapid setting emulsion, RS grade, medium setting MS grade, and slow setting SS grade. Now you heard about RS1, RS2, SS1, SS2, these are the different types of setting rates for different emulsion we are using. And in the cutbacks, we have different solvent to have rapid setting, medium setting. Here what we do is that we increase the amount of the chemical, the emulsifying agent. More we add, it takes more time to set. So we control the setting rate by the type and amount of emulsifying agent. So now let's go to the type of emulsions we have in India and elsewhere. We have rapid setting on the left side, and that we use RS grade, that will be used for tack coat. Now don't get confused with the, in here we have RS1, RS2, then we have CRS1, CRS2. This one is C means stands for cationic. It's called cationic rapid setting. RS is anionic, there is no A in there, but understood is anionic. In the India, what you have done is that we use only cationic, so we didn't use C, you know. In my opinion, we should have left C in there, because if somebody comes from USA as expert or whatever, he will be confused. When we tell him that we got a RS1 grade, he will think it will be like anionic emulsion. So we are using the CRS1 and CRS2, which are we call them RS1, RS2, and these are rapid setting emulsion for the tack coat on surface dressing. When you apply a tack coat, we want to pave right away, you know. After we apply the tack coat, we want the emulsion to set very fast, so that, you know, we can pave it. Same thing, surface treatment is more like surface dressing. When you apply the rapid, the RS1 grade, and then you apply the stone chips on top of that, we want to set it very fast, so that we can open to the traffic. So that's where we use the rapid setting. Medium setting we will use for the road mix. If we have to mix this emulsion with this aggregate stone, we cannot use rapid setting. As soon as you start to mix, you know, it will set on you immediately, so you cannot even make a mix out of it. So for the mix, you know, we use medium setting. And slow setting we can also use for the road mix. If you got too many fines, we use slow setting for slurry seal, or also for micro-surfacing. In the US they also use for tack coat, although we don't use in the India for tack coat, we can also use for fog seal. So this is SS grade. So you got RS grade, MS grade, and SS grade. So these are the three kinds of emulsions we have in India, depending upon rapid setting, medium setting, and slow setting. Okay, now we are going to talk about the conventional physical properties of testing of paving bitumen, that's the second part. And now this is all upon paving bitumen only. Bitumen physical test, we must understand these tests, you know, because as a user, if say Bharat Petroleum or Hindustan Petroleum supplies you with VG30 or VG10, we must understand all these tests, you know, so we can get them done in our lab and find out whether it meets the IS 73, the code from BIS, you know. So we must understand these tests. So I'll just briefly go over these tests. Details are in your handouts, or you can refer back to the BS code. So there are five categories of these tests. One is the test for consistency, like how thick or thin the bitumen is, like consistency, you know, like honey. Honey will be have a high consistency than water, you know, it's thicker than water. So for that we have three tests, penetration, viscosity and softening point. These measure the consistency of the bitumen. Then we have aging test. There are two of them. Why do we have aging test? Because when I'm making a mix, you know, in the hot mix plant, my aggregate is very high temperature. What will be the temperature of the aggregate roughly? 180, 160, 150, things like that. And bitumen will also be about the same temperature. And then I'm mixing in a pug mill, I'm throwing the above, you know, so you get, there is a lot of oxidation taking place because the bitumen is in a very thin film. It might be like 8 micron thin, you know. So it gets exposed at high temperature to air. So it becomes very hard during those 45 seconds. The mixing time might be 30 seconds or 45 seconds. Becomes hard. Your VG10 might become VG30 or VG40, you know. Your penetration might be from 60, it might go down to 40 within those few seconds. So aging test, you know, tells me how much this bitumen is going to age during that mixing operation. So it's like a test we are simulating in the laboratory to find the aging during the mixing only. Then once you put down the mix on the project, you know, that will age, also ages very slowly. After 1 year, 2 year, 5 year, the bitumen is still getting oxidized, being aged. But we are not talking about that. When here we are talking about only during production. So we got thin film oven test and rolling thin film oven test. And then we got a purity test. How pure is the bitumen? For that we have a test for solubility. Somebody might mix like marble dust. Like in Rajasthan, there's a big mafia, you know, the bitumen is coming, VG-30 is coming in the tanker. They will take one ton out of the tanker, you know, put marble dust in it. Which is just cheap, surplus. And if your bitumen is like, these days is not that expensive. It used to be like 50,000 rupees per ton. Now it's like going down to 40 or something. So you can just, you know, earn by putting one ton of marble dust, you know, you are making 40,000 rupees, you know. So you got to have some sort of a tool to find out if somebody has really put something in there. And how do I find out? So the test for solubility is very, very easy to do. Then we have a safety test, which is called flash point. We want to find out whether there is any kerosene in there or some petrol was left over when the tanker was, you know, changed or whatever. And we can detect that from the flash point. There are some other tests like ductility and specific gravity. And now we will talk about these one by one. So let's talk about the test for consistency. I'm going to discuss these very briefly. Just the definition is the consistency describes the viscosity or the degree of fluidity of a bitumen at any particular temperature. If I want to compare bitumen A and B, I can only compare at one temperature because as I know, if I increase the temperature, the viscosity will go down, stiffness will go down, because bitumen is a thermoplastic material, it changes its viscosity with temperature. I'll go to the next slide. So the routine test for consistency would be viscosity at 60 degrees Celsius. Why do we choose 60 degrees Celsius? I mean, we can determine the consistency at many temperatures, but we have chosen these three. 60 degrees because that's the near maximum surface temperature of the asphalt pavement. Now in Rajasthan or elsewhere, it might be 70 degrees, yes, but 60 degrees is pretty close. So they chose in the US that and elsewhere, they are everybody using 60 degrees Celsius. So I'm interested in 60 degrees because I want to know during the summertime how soft and hard my bitumen is. I want to know that, you know. That's why I want to test at 60 degrees Celsius. I also want to test at 135. Because that's the temperature near the mixing and lay down temperature of the asphalt mix. I want to find out what kind of viscosity I have at that temperature. And then I also use the penetration at 25 degrees Celsius, because that's more like an average surface temperature throughout the year. You take average, you can say, okay, 25 degree might be winter and some summer, you know, average temperature for that. Then viscosity at, so we'll talk about viscosity now. Before that, we are saying viscosity at 60 degrees Celsius, viscosity at 135, and penetration at 25 degrees. So now we are talking about these, we are going to talk about these three tests now. Viscosity at 60 degrees Celsius is the resistance to flow of a fluid test. It's measured by Canon Manning vacuum viscometer. That's the one which is used. I mean, you must be familiar. If you get a VG30 grade, the first thing you are going to conduct is this test. Only this test will tell you whether you got a VG30 or you got a VG10 or whatever. You want to find out the grade of the bitumen. This is the first test you got to run. So you must know about this test though. So a Canon Manning vacuum viscometer is done. And what I will do, go to the next slide to show to you very easily. Here is the viscometer. It's called vacuum viscometer, is used. There's a filling line here. So you pour the bitumen, you heat the bitumen and pour it, so it comes to filling line on both sides. Both sides will level out. And you put this tube at what temperature? Water bath. At what temperature? You are measuring this viscosity at 60 degrees Celsius, so your water bath should be maintained at 60 degrees Celsius. So the bitumen will come to that temperature, right? Now you are ready to run the test. So on the left side of the tube, you apply vacuum, because at 60 degrees Celsius, the bitumen is not going to flow by itself. If it flows by itself, then we'll be in trouble. You know, in the summertime, we will have liquid bitumen on hand, you know. So at that temperature, I have to apply partial vacuum on the left. So the bitumen starts to rise, you know. Once I apply the vacuum, it was level over here, start to rise. And there are timing marks here, so I time from here to here, A to B and B to C. I measure time in second with the stopwatch. Each tube comes with a calibration factor. So I multiply the time in second by calibration factor, and that is your viscosity in poises. It's a very simple test, you know. So you must run that test. And here in this is the whole setup here. You can see here on the left side, there are three tubes are there. I'm running three tests at the same time. And these hose pipe you see here, these are the vacuum. I'm applying vacuum. And on the right side, you see the equipment, that's a vacuum controller. You have to apply a vacuum of a specified amount, you know, because viscosity is a fundamental test. It's a stress divided by rate of strain. Stress is equal to the vacuum of applying, and strain is the movement of the bitumen we saw from point A to point B. So it's a fundamental test, you know, engineering test, you know, I'm measuring. So you have to really control the your vacuum very good. So that's the viscosity at 60 degrees Celsius, which you must have the equipment. This is the first equipment you must have to find out the grade was supplied by Indian Oil Company or whatever. Then the next viscosity is kinematic viscosity at 135 C, and that you need to know to find out what kind of mixing or compaction temperature you are going to use on the job. So I'm just going to go to the next slide, which will explain it better. Next slide, you can see on the left side of the top, you pour the bitumen, which lays in this reservoir. You see this tube here up to filling line. Bitumen is stored here in there. Then I push with my thumb here so that the bitumen comes over the siphon and start to flow. Because at 135 degrees Celsius, the bitumen is just like oil. It will flow very readily. I don't apply any vacuum, you know. Once I go over the siphon, it starts to flow immediately. Because just like oil, motor oil, you know, It's very thin. So it starts to oil, then it comes here and quickly come timing mark A and timing mark B. So I just time it again, you know. When it comes here, I start my stopwatch. Stop my stopwatch here. And then again, I have a calibration factor for this. And so I multiply the calibration factor with the time in seconds. So that will give me viscosity, kinematic viscosity at 135 degrees Celsius. Any questions you have so far? I'm not asking for any question, but if things are not very clear, you just stop me. I'm going very fast, you know, because we don't have much time. But you stop if there's any question. So here the picture of this kinematic viscosity. You can see here the bitumen is laying over here in the black, you know. I still have to thumb over it so it starts to dump flow. So it's an oil bath. You cannot use water bath at 135 C. So you have to use the oil bath. Now we go to our old penetration test. Penetration test is an empirical, it's not a fundamental, empirical measure of consistency determined by measuring how far a needle penetrates. It has a needle of a specified size, bitumen sample in small metal or glass container. Okay, let me go to the next slide which will explain it better. So what I have here on the left side, I have the bitumen at 25 degrees Celsius in a container and a needle which is just touching the surface of the bitumen, and the needle is loaded with 100 gram. The weight of the needle plus the weight is 100 gram total. So once I do that, it's just touching over here, I release the needle for 5 seconds. So it will penetrate whatever you do in 5 seconds, and I just stop it at that point and I measure the how much it has penetrated. Each 0.1 millimeter is one penetration unit. So if you got a 60 pen bitumen, how much you have? How much is it penetrated? 6 millimeter. So here is the picture of the penetrometer. I mean, you must have that because we also have in IS 73 we have requirement for penetration as well. So first test we are going to run is the viscosity. Then you must run the penetration as well. Then we have the third measurement for consistency, the softening point. Softening point, and it's called ring and ball softening point. Softening point actually evaluates the temperature at which the phase change occurs in the bitumen. Phase change means my bitumen might be semi-solid when it becomes semi-liquid. Is a very crude definition, semi-solid, that's my softening point. To measure that, the definition is that the temperature at which bitumen specimen cannot support its own weight and start flowing. So let me go to the next slide which is explained better. So in the softening point test we have, the next slide you have, we have a ring which is bitumen is there, it's open on both sides, you know. So I pour the bitumen and let it cool down, and then I put it on the bracket and I put a steel ball on top of it. Now at room temperature it will support the steel ball. Room temperature is pretty stiff, you know, so it will support the steel ball. Then I gradually increase the temperature of this. I'm using the ethyl alcohol in there. So I am gradually increasing the temperature of this liquid, so the bitumen becomes soft and soft. It becomes soft to such an extent that it cannot support the weight of the steel ball, and the whole thing starts to fall toward the bottom of the beaker. So the steel ball will fall down, also grabbing the bitumen along with that. As soon as it hits the bottom of the beaker, I read the temperature in the thermometer. And that's my softening point. It's a very crude test. You know. It's an empirical test. So when you hear about softening point, that's how you measure. So now we have dealt with the test for consistency. We talk about viscosity of two types. We have talked about penetration to determine the consistency. Now you talk about the thin film oven, which is the aging test. In the thin film oven test, what happens during those 45 seconds, which I mentioned to you before, we want to simulate that in the lab. So I'll show you the next slide, which will explain you better. Here we have a oven and we have a rotating shelf in which I have a very thin pan in which I will put the bitumen in there. Bitumen is very, very, very thin. It's not like, I cannot simulate 8 micron, you know, so it's like 1/8 inch. 1/8 inch will be like 3 millimeter.
1/8.
Yeah, about 3-4 millimeter. Take, you know, bitumen is there in these thin pans, you know, I can put 3 or 4 pans in there. It rotates and my temperature is 325 degree Celsius, which is 163 degrees Celsius. So I have a high temperature, it rotates, it gets a lot of oxygen, and I let it rotate for 5 hours. And then I take out the bitumen and test it for viscosity or penetration, whatever I want to do then. It's supposed to simulate that hardening which will take place in a hot mix plant during the 30-40 seconds. I don't want a bitumen which hardens too much, you know. If it hardens too much in there, then that bitumen is not going to last too long, you know. In the real life, it will also harden more. So we have a specification in IS 73 that viscosity can only increase 4 times. It cannot go more than 4 times, you know. It goes 5 times, it's rejected. Here is the picture of that thin film oven test. You can see the bitumen is laying in there, you know, in the 2 trays in there. It rotates 5 hours. Takes quite a while. So the substitute for this test, which is very popular now, and we have also adopted it in India, is the rolling thin film oven test. Now we don't use any TFO anymore from 2013. We changed our specification. Now we allow only rolling thin film oven test. It takes only 75 minutes. Let me show you in the slide here. In this one, what I have is I have just like these are like wine racks, you know. I have bottles. I have bitumen put in a bottle which are laid in these holes horizontally, and then the whole thing moves, you know. And then the bottles, the bitumen is in the bottles. There are 8 bottles. So when this whole wheel moves, you know, the bitumen in the bottle also moves in a thin film and is exposed to air. And I also have a air jet here. When this bottle comes here, I just put a jet air, lot of oxygen in there, you know. When the next one comes there, I put like a puff of air. So I can do this same thing which happened in 5 hours there in 75 minutes. So this rolling film test is very good because it gives you more quantity and also exposes, especially for PMB and other kind of material. You know, this test is very good. Here the equipment for the rolling thin film oven. All the controls here, the left side, and then 8 bottles, you know, on the right side. And then we come to the test for solubility, and I told you too that it's very important to determine the bitumen purity in terms of percentage soluble in trichloroethylene. If I got a mineral matter like dust or whatever, you know, marble dust or whatever, I use a solvent trichloroethylene which will dissolve all the bitumen. Any other impurity will not get dissolved. So all I'm doing is just I've dissolved the bitumen which I receive in that solvent. Then I got a flask with a filter on the top, glass fiber filter on the top. So I pour the bitumen. All the mineral material will retain on that filter. It's a very fine filter, and all the solvent with bitumen will go down. So I weigh the filter before and after, and then I can find out how much, you know, mineral matter or impurity, marble dust, whatever you have most of the time your bitumen is 99.9% pure. Purity is never in a question unless you know somebody is playing a mischief in there. You know, so this test is very simple. I think this would also be run by the buyer. So here the equipment for the test for solubility. Here the flask, you know, and here is the filter, and I pour the bitumen dissolved in a trichloroethylene solvent. So this will be mineral material will be just held over here on the filter. Then for the safety test, I got a flash point test. Flash point is the temperature at which the bitumen gives off enough vapor which can flash or ignite in the presence of a spark or open flame. Cleveland open cup method is used. That's what we also used in India. And I'll show you the next slide which will explain it better.
Sir, this includes your fire point test also, sir?
Yeah, there's also a fire point. But we don't have any specification for fire point. Right now we're just looking for a flash, you know.
Yes.
And if you keep on increasing temperature,
you'll
get the fire. But we don't have any specification for that. And also the fire point is much above the flash point, you know. They are not very close by. So it never have been a concern. As long as it meets the flash point, you know, it's okay. In the flash point, I said you have like a brass cup. You put the bitumen in there and you gradually heating it. There is a prescribed rate of heating gradually, and occasionally you bring out a flame. You see on the left side with the hand, this person is holding a flame from like Bunsen burner or whatever, which you can just occasionally bring it on the top of the bitumen. So it is like a swing, you know, swings, you know. So if you have not reached the flash point, nothing happens. Once you have reached the flash point, then this flame will just give you a small flash, you know. That means you have reached the flash point. At that point, you read the temperature. So that's your flash point. So you never want to exceed that flash point. Whatever is given in the specification, there's a maximum flash point in there for VG30, VG. You should never, if it is below that, then you can expect some contamination. There could be some kerosene in there or some petrol or whatever, you know, you can expect that. But from the safety point of view, it is very important to measure the flash point. So here is the picture of the flash point. You can see here, this is the, I can swing it out, swing it in. It has a flame in it, the thermometer. So it's called Cleveland open cup flash point test, and that's what we used in India as well. We also have a test for ductility. Ductility is the ability of the bitumen to be stressed or drawn without breaking. It's an empirical test, and I'll show you in the next picture, that will be better. So in the test, there are two molds, so half mold is here, half is there. So when I start the test, they are joined together. They are joined together, right here. I pour the bitumen, let it cool down, and usually I'll measure 25 degrees Celsius. So the water bath is at 25 degrees Celsius. Once I pour it, then one end of the ductility mold is fixed. Another is I'm moving it away. Whatever rate is given, like 5 centimeters per minute or whatever the prescribed rate, I'm moving it away. So the bitumen is like stretches, you know, because it's a very, very thin thread. As soon as the thread breaks, there's a centimeter scale here. I read the ductility in centimeter, whether it's 50 centimeter, whatever. And I can run 3 tests at one time, you know. So then you can get an average of these 3 tests. So it's a very empirical test, because I don't know what the stress is. I don't know what the strain is. As I'm stretching, your area is changing, you know. Yeah. Where you are applying the stress, you know, whatever stress you are applying is changing. So it's a very empirical test. But does indicate something. If your bitumen is really bad, it won't stretch it at all. Now here you have a picture of a 50 penetration bitumen. It broke earlier than the PMB. Just to show you, the big that PMB, like especially the SBS type PMB, will stretch it pretty fast. Then we also have a specific gravity of the bitumen we use for the mixed design, and this is simply a bitumen binder, weight divided by volume, and we use the pycnometer method for this. This slide shows a pycnometer. It's a simple method to find the weight and the volume of the bitumen. This is the last slide, and then we can. Now this one I'm just showing a historical picture, many years ago, 100 years ago, what kind of bitumen equipment we had. You can see here the wave, the kind of balance we had, the penetrometer and the sieves and all that. Just a historical picture. So with that, if you got a good bitumen, you will have good bitumen road. So that's the first lecture on.
Hello. Excuse me. If you have any questions, you can please raise now. And somebody's mic is still on. When you are speaking only, please switch on the mic. Otherwise, please mute it.
Any questions they might have?
If you have any questions, you can ask. Otherwise, we will continue in your 5 minutes the second one. If we don't do aging test, what will happen? In what way it will impact the aging test?
Okay. The question here is that if I don't do the aging test like RTFO, rolling kiln flow 1, what will happen? Because we have a requirement in our specification that due to that aging, the viscosity should not go more than 4 times, because there are some bad bitumen out there. Depending upon the petroleum crude, bitumen can change from one well to another well. So the one bitumen can be a very low durability, and that will increase in viscosity 6 times. If it increases 6 times in my RTFO test, then in the real life it will also age faster. After 1 year, 2 year, bitumen always ages. That's a starting point. Once you put down the mix on the project, then after 1 year the bitumen will become harder. Your viscosity will keep on increasing every year. So if I got a bad bitumen which failed the RTFO test, it's also going to age faster in the real life. So I won't get the durability, this service life.
DBM and DC mixes, sir?
No. There is a cold mix also there. DBM and BC are hot mixes.
They're hot mixes.
Okay, whenever you use emulsion, we call it cold mix. So it will be cold mix. For the cold mix, you can use it if you don't have any hot mix nearby,
yes.
Your hot mix plant is far, far away, you can use a cold mix. You cannot open to the traffic right away.
Yes.
The cold mix, you have to get the water out,
Yes.
So if it's a new road, you can use a cold mix because you don't have traffic, open to the traffic. So there are limitations, Also, the strength of the cold mix won't be as good as a hot mix.
Yes.
But if you got a low traffic and no nearby hot mix plant, cold mix would be a good alternative with using emulsion.
Yeah.
But not with BC and DBM. We'll call it a cold mix.
Cold mix can be used as a bearing course or that a base course.
Yeah, if you got a low traffic. You can use both for varying and
varying also.
Yeah, but very low traffic.
Sure.
So it looks like this. we don't have a lecture, you know, on the mixes. I have a separate lecture. We don't have time, you know. I have a mix lecture only on mixes, where you talk about BC, DBM, cold mixes, stone matrix asphalt. You might have heard SMA.
Yes, no,
yeah, yeah. That lecture has that.
It's so included in the recent report also.
Yeah.
Ductility test also, how it is useful in our ductility?
Yeah, right now in the IS 73 2013, we have a requirement on ductility after the RTFO. First you run the rolling thin film oven, and then it has to meet like 50 centimeter or 75 meter, whatever. I am a firm believer in the test for ductility. It's like an elastic, you know, it gives you some idea about, I'm an old timer, you know. So, and if you, sometimes you air blow too much, you know, like the VG, the Jugaad VG 40 people are doing. If you air blow it too much, you know, then your ductility will be less, will be lost. So you can indirectly, you know, catch them. So the ductility test is also a indicator of different blending of crudes. Supposing I have Iranian crude and Iraqi crudes, and these oil companies will sometimes blend them, you know. If there is a lack of compatibility between two crudes, it will show up as a low ductility.
Okay.
So it has very indirectly meaning, you know. It may not, it is an empirical test, you know, but still has some meaning. I believe in that. So some ductility is required. Like SBS, elastic elastomer, you know, we have high ductility. And
small last question, sir.
Pardon?
Air blown alone will change the quality of the bitumen, sir.
Air blowing, sir. Air blowing, yeah, it will change. You know, air blowing can only be done. Air blowing should always be done only in the refineries. Just to tweak the bitumen viscosity.
Yes.
Supposing you are falling short of VG30, you know.
Yes.
Just do some little bit air blowing, and then it will increase your viscosity. Very little, just to tweak it.
Okay.
If you do too much, you know, then your ductility will suffer.
Yes.
And the durability of bitumen won't be that durable.
Yes.
So that's why these fly-by-night third parties are doing air blowing VG4.
They are doing, sir.
Yeah, they are not supposed to. IS 73 for paving bitumen clearly says that all the VG grades shall be manufactured by refining processes only.
Yes.
So these third party are not supposed to do that. You know, that was my issue I took up with NHIE. You are not on my mailing list, so you don't know what I'm doing.
Sir, another question. Can emulsion be made at site? Because there is one argument that the emulsion contains more water only. Actually, are we paying the transport charges for water?
Yeah, well, no, it cannot be made by, you have to have that equipment for making emulsion, which is mostly imported from like Netherlands and all that from the area. So you have to have that equipment to make a good emulsion. Then you must have a good lab. Making emulsion is very, very complicated, much complicated than making a paving bitumen. It has a lot of things, you know, it has the compatibility of the bitumen and whatever you are doing. So you have to run a test for distillation to find out how much water is there. Normally like 35% is water, 65% is bitumen.
Yes.
So immediately you have to run a test for distillation. You'll find out how much bitumen he added. If the water is more than 35%, then he added water in there. So you must, as a buyer, you have to test it. You know, otherwise, people are doing all kind of things. You know, they add bitumen water in there. Then not only you are paying for a transportation, and then you are not getting your money's worth bitumen. You know, you are paying for water. So, emulsion technology here is still in infancy. And many contractors have bought the equipment, you know. They said, why should I buy from a refinery emulsion? Let me make my own, you know.
My own.
And those people are just novels. They don't have any idea is how tough it is to make it. So as a buyer, I must find out, you know.
Like CRM.